sure she keep cooking and cleaning. Now, if my perception of her is to love and honor her, and to love her, as the scriptures say, as Christ loved the church, if that's my perception, then it's going to be an entirely different way I treat and honor her. You know, now I mentioned job, it can go in with your church. You know, how do you perceive your church? Do you perceive your church as just somewhere you come on Sunday? Because you ain't got nothing else to do? Is your perception of coming to church, well, I come so things can be right with me? So perception, how you perceive things affects how you live your life. See, that's with anything. Now, I'm not saying what's right or wrong at the time, or good or bad. It's your perception of things. Now, if you get nothing else out of this, really, how you perceive life affects how you live your life. All of us are living our lives based on our perception of it. And that goes with any and everything, from your job to your parents, those of you who are parents, how you raise your children, all of that. What is your perception? You know, what is my perception of having good health? And we know we got various perceptions on that, because my perception of it is going to affect how I live it, how I treat it. Some people perceive, hey, eating healthy, that don't mean nothing. Doing a little walking, hey. And that's how you live your life. Now, I told them in the first service, I said, I don't want nobody's brain to hurt. Because I might say some things that your brain might, but just stay with the message. We may or may not shout. Can't guarantee either way. Hallelujah. Tell somebody the power of perception. Now, if this is true, then could we say when a person's life is off or out of order, is because their perception is out of order? Now, I've been given these examples of those of us who've been raised in families or had, you know, several brothers and sisters. It's something how we can all be raised in the same household, you know, and same parents and heard the same thing and all of that, but then we have a different perception about life. You know, maybe you had a parent who said, hey, you're supposed to work, because you saw that. And then you could have 8, 9 of us raised in the same house. We saw that. We saw our parent working and providing and all of that. But trust me, out of that group, somebody in there is going to perceive, I ain't got to work. Now, before you say that ain't true, it's probably you. You the lazy one out of the bunch. I'm serious on that. I learned that some years ago. I'm not talking about maybe 2 or 3, but multiple ones. Entirely different perception. Now, like I said, those of you who say, nah, that ain't true, it's you. Same thing with the Word of God. You know, we sit here week after week, we can hear the same word by the same person, but a different perception. Now, why is that? A few reasons for that. Because of your level of learning. You know, our perception affects how we learn. Then with others, it's their perception on what's being taught. Now, a message like this, Some folks can receive it, but then there are others like, this is hurting my brain. I didn't come here for that. I came here to hear Jesus gonna fix it. Well, let me get news. Jesus already fixed it. You just got the wrong perception. See, if you change your perception, you'll know Jesus has already fixed it. So with others, it's their perception of what's being taught. Then with others, it's their perceiving things based on where they're at in life at the moment. You know, see, it's just like, now I've been on this series for the last couple weeks. And some of the same things I'm saying today, I said 2 weeks ago. But sometimes we can have a different perception because depending on where we're at that time. See, with some, when you first heard it 2 weeks ago, you know, your emotions were somewhere else. Now you're kind of straight. Now you're hearing it differently. See, that's why I understand the ministry of Jesus when throughout scripture, when you say, again, I say unto you. And that ain't no criticism. I mean, because sometimes we be at different places at different times. The mental place you in right now can change an hour from now. Sometimes some people's perception is determined by their emotions. And I said in the first service, you know, when you're feeling emotionally strong and secure, you have a certain perception. You know how that is when you just feel like you're just having a good day? You know, you wake up feeling good and just, you know, a good day and this and that. And there's a certain perception of life that you take with you. But now in the same token, when you have a person who's feeling emotionally insecure, emotionally drained, and just emotionally weak, then there's another perception. You know, when you're feeling good, hey, you know, somebody can walk past you, you can say, hey, what's up? They don't say nothing. Hey, you don't think nothing about it. But then when you're feeling emotionally insecure and drained and low, and then you are in somebody, you say something, they don't say nothing. You get all. And I've said this too, you've got to be careful to not see life through emotional eyes. Why? Because emotions, and I've said this for years, emotions can be manipulated. And whatever can be manipulated, you really can't depend on it. Now, are emotions real? Yes, they are. But that doesn't make them true. You know that depends on if you're my age or older or around that time. Years ago, you'd have to tell a girl if you wanted her that you really cared about her. Even though, you know, some of us brothers who wasn't right and wasn't saved, we didn't mean it. You know, but we were hoping they believed it. And depending on the outcome, you know whether they believed it or not. Now, was that emotion real for them? Yeah. But was it true? Nope. Now, I'm an equal opportunist. Before somebody say, that's why I say men ain't what up. Trust me. I knew a lot of girls who did the same thing. That's another message for another time. Because I just kind of felt that. See, that's why men, no. You know, that would play a guys, but believe me, that were plenty of player women, plenty of player girls. told you what you thought you wanted to hear too. All right. So our emotions, we've got to be careful to not see life through our emotions because they can be manipulated. We know that when we dream. When you dream, it can seem so real. You know, if you have a nightmare, you wake up, you know, hey. You know, anybody ever had nightmares? You know, like, and you wake up, and I've been there. You wake up kind of shaking, and sometimes it takes a minute to shake it off. You know, I've had bad dreams before where I woke up and had to turn the lights on. Hey, I'm an old grown man. You know, like hey, like I shake that thing off. Wake my wife up, you know, say, snap out of this. Wait, hey. But was it true? No. You know, watching a movie. We get so caught up and emotionally involved in a make-believe story. That's not true. And is the emotions real? Yes, we got the proof. You crying. Am I the only one that's ever shed tears at a movie? Just looking at it, knowing is make-believe, and these are actors. But you get so emotionally tied up in there, you know, with guys, me being a macho guy, you'd be like biting your tongue and trying not to let nobody know you crying. Then you swallow it. But was it real? No. But the emotions were. See, I quoted what one man said. He said, perception is reality. And we've established throughout this series that perception carries influential and persuasive power. Because how you see, what you see, who you see, when you see, and even where you see can determine the path or the road that leads to your destiny. Why is this so important? Because how you see things, what you see, who you see, when you see, and even where you see, especially when you're going through a challenge, especially when it comes to making certain decisions. It's very important. Now, in the last service, I dealt with a couple of them. How do you see? You know, what is your perception? What eyes are you looking through? You know, are you looking through emotional eyes? Are you looking at life based on your situation? A lot of folk do that. They're looking at life now based on where they at, what they're going through. Are you looking through jealous eyes? And if not all of us, many of us, we've been there. My 52 years of life, have I ever been jealous? Yes! Absolutely. It's not a good feeling. It's not a good feeling to be jealous. And that's one of those areas that you just don't want to admit. So are you looking through jealous eyes? Are you looking through unforgiving eyes? Are you looking through bitter eyes? Are you looking through feeling sorry for yourself eyes? You know, folks they start looking at life, viewing it, because they feel sorry for themselves. They look, they see everything, they feel sorry for themselves. Nobody just don't know what I'm going through. And that's not how they look in life. They're looking at life through feeling sorry for myself eyes. can't be happy for nobody. If you see any form of happiness, it makes you sad. You're looking for somebody should be doing something for me. You can't help nobody because you got like somebody should be helping me. So how do you see? How are you perceiving things? I gave this example in the first service that could it be the reason you couldn't move into that property? Was because of how you saw it. Or the reason you couldn't start that business, because of how you saw it. Or the reason you didn't go back to school, because of how you saw it. Now we can go on and on and on, because how you saw it. In other words, you saw it as too big. You may have saw it as this is just too expensive. This is too much of a responsibility. That's one of the reasons some folk never want to own anything. They'd rather stay in the rental stage. Now, I'm not saying being in the rental stage is a bad thing. I'm not saying that. But the reason some folk don't want to do that because of how they see it. See, when you're in the rental phase, you know, if rain starts dripping down on the ceiling, you call the landlord. When you're in the ownership stage and you see rain dripping down, you better call somebody to fix it. It's about the perception. How do you see when it comes to giving? You know, I know some of this is a little self-inventory. What is your perception when it comes to giving? You know, Minister Jonathan was saying some things earlier about Pastor All Day and this. Some folk, don't raise your hand. Some folks' perception would be like, have the wrong perception. Why give him some? He got more than me. What is your perception when it comes to giving? Now, I tell you with that, when it comes to giving to the Lord and the church, now that's all based on your perception of what you think of him. Because how you value and treat things is based on your perception of that. See, if I perceive God and his church like this, I'm going to treat it like that. Hallelujah. You know, are you looking through lack and poverty eyes? Now, I'm not coming against you. I'm just, you know, hey, and I understand. Some folks do that. When it comes down to giving, they looking through the eyes of poverty and lack. I can't do that. Let me throw this. And this is, you get this for free since we're talking about offerings and giving and stuff. Some of us got to change our perception about money in itself. Some of us have to change our perception to the levels of it. Stop thinking $100 is a lot. Amen. Now, I shot very low by saying that. See, some of us can't grow in certain areas because of our perception. See, if you're still thinking $100 is a whole lot of money, trust me, it's going to affect how you live.
Amen.
You got to change your perception on that. Like I say, I shot low with 100.
Amen.
And some folks, you know, really, they perceive, oh, that's a whole, you know. Some people, if they misplace a dollar, they will tear down the house looking for a dollar. Tear down the house. Pull clothes all out everywhere. Just, where is my dollar? Just, you done messed up your whole place. over 100 pennies. That's going to now take you 3 hours to get your house back together. Because of how you perceive it. I don't know if anybody caught that one. Trust me, that line right there will change your perception about money. Stop thinking $1,000 is a whole lot. $10,000. $20,000. See, when you change your perception of that, then I'll get into later, then it'll get drawn to you. It gets easier. See, if you think it's so much, then it's so far away and near impossible to ever get to. Ooh, some of y'all slept on that billion-dollar nugget right there. Next thing, what did you see? Because what you saw was based on how you saw it. Let's go to 2 Corinthians 4. So somebody say, I didn't need another word. Some of you right now don't need another word. You just need to adjust your perception on what you already know. You know how we can get some time. I need to hear a word. Okay, this is your word right now. See, with some of us, all we got to make that little tweak and start seem right. Second Corinthians, the 4th chapter, verse 8 says, we are troubled on every side, yet not distressed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Cast down, but not destroyed. Now, this is about perception here. You know, this is what one perceived. One saw this. One saw, I'm troubled. I'm perplexed. I'm persecuted. I'm cast down. I ain't got no friends. Nobody like me. I'm broke. I'm sick. I'm lonely. Got to crack my neck again. That's one's perception. As you just don't know what I'm going through. This has been the roughest year of my life. Now this is what the other saw. I'm not distressed. I'm not in despair. I'm not forsaken, and I'm not destroyed. Some of y'all ain't getting it. We understand a challenge is going on. We understand that. And one is perceiving it as, yeah, I know I'm going through because I'm troubled, I'm perplexed, I'm persecuted, and I'm cast down. But the other one is saying, yeah, I know that's there, but I'm not distressed. I'm not in despair, amen. And I'm not forsaken, and I'm not destroyed. You know that expression, I may be down, but I'm not out? You know, it might look a little shaky, but it's not over. What have I been saying for years and years? As faith believers, we don't play 9 innings. We don't play 4 quarters. We play until we win. See, but this is all about the perception. And you could be going through something. Now remember, I've said this before, and you got to keep this in your mental Rolodex. Sometimes what we think is pressure to quit can just be a push for you to grow. See, so your perception, do I perceive this? Is this pressure or is this a push? You know, because let's be honest, some of us need a push. Some folk ain't going nowhere unless they get pushed. And you think it's pressure, and sometimes it's just a push. Everything is not always the devil. You know, I always give this story years ago when we were on public aid. Now, so anybody saying coming against it, I'm not saying you're wrong. That's not it. And we were on public aid. Now, I was working at the time. I just wasn't making much money. You know, there's a certain amount of money. I'm not sure how they do it now, but at that time, if you made a certain amount of money, you qualified for food stamps and a medical card. And depending on how many people is in your family. And at that time, you know, it was my income and there's six people. Myself, my wife, and four children. And it was every month you'd send in your copies of your check stubs. And, you know, and then they'd determine whatever you were eligible for, and that was fine. And then as I start really getting into the word of faith, and this didn't even get to appear when I was the pastor. You know, and I'm changing in certain things, and I know God is whatever, but I'll be honest, at that time, I just still didn't have that courage. Then they sent us a letter. This had to be in late October, because you're figuring at this time, you're getting ready for the holiday. Or this could have been, I don't remember, one of the months, but close to the Thanksgiving Christmas holiday. And sent a letter and saying, you next month, you're going to be discontinued for your benefits. And I'm like, what? We sent in everything, and then it said, you know, you can't appeal this. And we both knew. No, this is a defining moment. Now, did it feel like pressure? Yeah, but it wasn't pressure to quit. It was a push to grow. We didn't respond. Like, no, we believe in God on this. And however many years ago, and we never looked back since. Since I'm thinking about that, I remember leading up to before we were getting married. And we were looking, I was looking for a place, but then I think you applied for Section 8 at the time. And then it seemed like at that time, it seemed like everybody and their mama was able to get Section 8. But she couldn't get it. We couldn't get it. You know, I'm not kidding. It seemed like everybody and their mama. And then even after we married, time went on. Other people getting their Section 8. We're like, we applied a year ago, 2 years ago, and everybody just. But looking back on it. See, that would have been another thing. Now, before anybody, I'm not coming against it. Come on now, I'm just trying to give you some real life examples of sometimes what you think is pressure for you to quit is really a push for you to grow. Most times God will show you something that's bigger than your ability. Something bigger than what you thought of. Why? Because it's a push for you to grow.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Then the next thing is, who did you see? Now, once again, who you see is based on how and what you saw. So who do you see? Who do you see when you look in the mirror? Now, I know we all say, I see me. Well, the truth is you only see an image of you. You only see an image of you. I shared this in the first service, and I don't know if you've ever thought about this or not, but really, none of us have ever seen our faces.
Amen.
You've never seen your face.
Amen.
You've only seen an image of it. You've seen your hand. You've seen your arms. You've seen your clothes. You've seen your feet. You've seen certain parts. But you've never, ever seen your head. You've only seen an image of it. Because in order to get an image, you had to look in the mirror. You've never seen it like this.
Amen.
Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, I see something you've never saw. Some of y'all are slow in that. See, you can't play it off. You got to look at them. Because you're looking in their face. You're looking at something that they've never even seen. You've never seen it. Now, I understand maybe you never thought. You've never seen your face like this. See, you can actually see your hand. You've never seen your face like that. So based on how your head look, your hair, your face, either you're dependent on either somebody else or you're dependent on the image of what you see. Because you've never actually seen it. That'll be a neat trick if you can do that. So you've only seen an image, a reflection. Your only source of reality to that is what the mirror shows you. The mirror. And we know all mirrors are not the same. No, they're not. You got different kinds of mirrors. Some mirrors that's more close, further away, and then even some mirrors you can look in and you look different. You know, I go to different places and the mirror, it just looked different. Now, depending on where you're at and what you're doing, there's some mirrors you can look in and like you look better. You look more shapely. Then there are other mirrors. All right, play me off. Those of you who dare to look, that's your receipt for trying to. But all mirrors are not the same. You know those they used to have it at some circuses in some place. They'd have those weird mirrors that make you look all funny and make you look wide and all that. They're not all the same. Your rear view mirror on your car, your side mirrors, say what? The objects in here are closer than what they appear. In other words, you look on that side mirror and it looked like that car that's in back of you is kind of further behind, but it's really not. And that's why it tells you that objects are closer than what they appear. A mirror can be like an illusion. When we were out of town, we saw David Copperfield. He's a magician, been a magician for years. He's what's called an illusionist. Now, you know, I don't care how it looks, like they're cutting the lady in half. Amen. You know that's not true. Amen. That would be murder. But it's an illusion. It's not real, but it's an illusion. An illusion is something perceived in a way that's different from the way it is in reality. And some mirrors give that illusion. I said in the first service, anorexia. Anorexia, we understand the eating disorder and all of that kind of stuff, and because you have people make themselves throw up and all of that, and it's really a phobia. It's a fear that you're getting fat, but it's really a perception problem. That's all it really is. Because when they look in the mirror, they see themselves all real big and fat. In reality, they only 70 pounds. Perception. You know, you can look in the mirror and see a mole. Somebody can perceive it as a blessed birthmark. Perception. Let's go to James, first chapter of James. I'm not hurting anybody's brain, am I? See, I'm just that is power in how you perceive things. And if you have the right perception, it'll change your life. You know, some of us could be like, you know, with the word, how come the word ain't working for me? Pastor, I know what it said. This, maybe you need to just change your perception about it. That one little thing that can change your life about a lot of things. Yeah. It can be in your relationships. Yeah. It just seems like I'm going through this or that with my family or with my husband or wife. Maybe change your perception. Yeah. She's not just the chef and the maid. Now I'm mad because the chicken wasn't cooked the way I like it. And when I came in, the house wasn't spotless. See, and that goes with anything. Your perception. You know, with some young kids, your parents not your enemy. If you perceive them that they love you and want the best for you and trying to help you and trying to show you, then you won't have this attitude. Now, my parent, they trying to hold me down and hold me back. I can't wait till I get grown and get out. Oh, young grasshopper, little do you know. I tell folks, listen, enjoy your youth because you're only going to be that for a moment. That's it. Is that little? Unless you die at 21. But other than that, you're young that long. That small. Somewhat carefree, that short. Bills, when you're a kid, bills. know nothing about no bills when you were a kid. Turn the light on, leave the water running. Please. And expect food in the house. So some of you young ones, change your perception about your parents. Now, before somebody say, as you saying that because you want, no, that's not true. I always had a certain perception about my parents.
Amen.
And this is even prior to knowing Jesus. I just always knew they knew more than me.
Amen.
So before somebody get deep on that, you got nothing to do with it. Hallelujah. So now, James, first chapter, are we there? Okay, let me hurry. First chapter of James, verse 22 says, "But be ye doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. For if any be a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like unto a man beholding his face in a glass. For he beholdeth himself," and the glass means a mirror, "and goeth his way, and straightway," or immediately, "forgetteth what manner of man he was. But whoso looketh into the perfect law of liberty and continueth therein, he being not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, this man shall be blessed in his deed." Now, we know this passage says a lot, but I'm just emphasizing on a couple areas. Beholding his natural face in a glass, or looking at himself in a mirror. And then this passage brings up the word of God, brings up the perfect law of liberty. And it kind of makes that connection to that the word is like a mirror. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
See, and what the word does, see, a mirror gives you a reflection. But what the word does, it gives you the truth on how you really look, even naturally and spiritually. The word does that. The word gives you the truth. Listen, the word is the truth. The word tells you who you was, who you are, and who you're going to be. The word of God is the real root. You know, in other words, where you first began before the foundation of the world. Now, as believers, as a Christian, there's something that we're supposed to see whenever we look at or whenever we look into the Word. There is an image, and that image is found, you don't have to turn to it, in Genesis 1:26, when God said, "Let us make man in our image, after our likeness." So God created man in his own image. Look at somebody and say, "You are the image of God." Now, see, you can't see that if your perception is wrong. So every time we look in the Word, the mirror, you're not supposed to see broke, busted, and disgusted. You're not supposed to see weary, wounded, and sad. But you're supposed to see the image of who? God. Hallelujah. See, remember, the Bible or the Word is the expressed finished work of God. The perfect law of liberty is not being bound to your situation. It's not being bound to your problem, but it's about the manifestations of His promises. See, in other words, when we look in the Word, you're not looking in the Word to find someone or something that can relate to your problem. You're looking for the promise. Oh, Jesus. You see, most people in the body of Christ, they've got to change their perception when it comes to looking into the Word of God. Because how you perceive the Word is going to affect how you believe the Word. And obviously, how you believe the Word is going to affect how you receive the Word. which in turn is going to affect how you live your life as a Christian. You know, what is your perception of the Word of God? You know, you got to perceive it as these are the promises of God. You got to perceive it as this is who I am in God, who I am and whose I am. This word was sent to heal and to deliver me from every destruction. I'm not looking in this word to get some comfort or some sympathy or comfort. I want deliverance. I want breakthrough. Oh, thank you, Jesus. See, we've got to have the right perception. When I'm looking in that mirror, I don't see, oh, Paul, woe is me. See, if you don't see God when you're looking in the world, you got the wrong perception. See, that's why I said earlier, you know, what eyes are you looking through? You can't even look at this word coming through with feel sorry for yourself eyes, emotional eyes, none of that. What does Hebrews 11:6 says? He that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he's a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. I come to this word to see God. That really should be your perception when it comes to church. I'm coming to see God. See, if that's your real perception, then you won't get bothered by it if somebody don't speak to you. That's their issue, not yours. Hallelujah. See, if you got that wrong perception, and because of that wrong perception, we've either been limited or we've been cut off from receiving from God. Because if you don't perceive right, you're not going to believe right. And if you don't believe right, you're not going to be able to receive right. Nobody's brain is hurting, is it? See, I'm telling you, folks, something's all you need to do, change your perception. And a lot of folks in the body of Christ, they don't want to do that. Especially those who say, I'm just waiting on the Lord. What are you waiting? Change your perception. See, your perception of whose you are and who you are and what belongs to you makes all the difference in the world. Now, I said this on last week, that everything you need, want, and desire is already in your world. Everything you need, want, and desire is already here. Now, I know from a religious standpoint, we're used to saying God is getting ready to do something, but the truth of the matter is he's already done it. You know, God is getting ready to, and I understand we say, but the truth of the matter, he's already done it. God is not going to heal you. Healing has already been provided. And I know we say things, you know, he'll make a way out of no way. The way has already been made. Let's quickly go to Ephesians 1. Gosh, let me hurry. So everything you want, desire, is already in your world. The problem is you just don't see it. You haven't perceived it. First chapter of Ephesians, verse number 1. Says, grace be to God and peace from God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath means has, past tense, has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ, according as he has chosen us. Say, he didn't say he's getting ready to choose. Has chosen us in him. When? Before the foundation of the world. That we should be holy and without blame before him in love, having predestinated us unto the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good will of his pleasure. See, when did you become blessed? Before the foundation of the world. See, the thing is, we just don't see it. And what you can't perceive, you can't believe. And obviously, what you can't believe, you can't receive. So ain't we getting ready? He's already blessed you. Now, what's the problem? Let's go to 1 Corinthians 2 and 9. Hallelujah. First Corinthians 2 and 9. Now, this is one of those verses that has really, I've heard for years, and people, you know, they just do it out of ignorance. You just read it and people get excited about it and really don't know what they're excited about. 1 Corinthians 2 and 9 says, but as it is written, eye has not seen, nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for them that love him. Now, that was a time, you know, I'd hear that word and it just, you know, it gives you some measure of hope. You know, eyes haven't seen, ears haven't heard, neither has it entered into the heart the things that God has prepared for me. Okay, he's prepared for me. When am I going to get it? See, that it just sounds real good. You know, people use that in the prophetic. Eyes have not seen. Yay, I say. Ears have not heard. Neither has it entered into your heart. Now, when you kind of think about it, maybe that's the problem. I ain't heard nothing. I ain't seen nothing, and it ain't even in my heart. That's why I can't get it. Don't write me no ugly letters. Just pray for me. Just pray. Come on now. You know I'm telling the truth on that one. I ain't coming against you. I understand. When we really, really think about certain stuff, You know how we say, you say things like, he may not come when you want him, but he's right on time. When you really think, he may not come when I want him, but he's right on time. I mean, I needed him, but then I got put out. And then I had to spend 3 years being homeless. And then as a result, me being homeless out, and then I became a beggar, and then I got food poisoning, and then I got hospitalized, and this was a long 5-year process. But then all of a sudden, praise the Lord, I got an apartment right on time. I know I'm messing with your religion. I know it. Didn't come when I want them, but it was right on time. And it's that perception of God why a lot of folks don't trust God. Amen. And I know that's a religious excuse that we've used. I say we've used when things don't happen and we just make up stuff. Because that ain't scripture, because the scripture says he's a very present help in time of trouble. That's what the Bible says. We made up this other stuff. Because we had to give some excuse for why something didn't happen. Or did happen. See, since I'm there, I might as well go there now. It's like when a loved one passed and we don't understand, then we hear some preacher or somebody said, I blame us because we the leaders. And the congregation can't go no further than the leader. And it makes us feel better. The Lord took them. And you will not find nowhere in your Bible, with the exception of Moses and Elijah and Enoch, that the Lord took, or Jesus, if you want to, you know, after he was resurrected. When the Lord take you, there is no funeral. There is no body. I know I'm going to lose somebody on that, but get back with the truth. I'm telling you the truth. You can't refute it. You can't show me anything else. But see, I understand that's what we were told, and we believe that because that makes us feel better. And once again, it's that wrong perception that this God who you telling me to trust and love took my 13-year-old child or my loving, abiding father. You got to be kidding. The wrong perception. Wrong perception. Now, before somebody say, but don't it say in Job, the Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away? That's truly stated in the Bible, but it's not a statement of truth. Amen. See, you got to understand. I think it was in a Sunday school lesson. Job had no revelation or understanding of the time about a devil. That's why Job is the oldest book in the Bible. And it says he didn't sin because in his mind, hey, I'm going to still trust God and what happened. The Lord gave, the Lord took. Because he didn't have a mindset of my fear and the enemy did this thing. It's in the Bible, but it's not a statement of truth. That's just like somebody using the scripture in Ecclesiastes, a time to kill. That's why I killed my husband, because the Bible says time to kill. It do say it, that's a time to kill. It was his time to die. So I killed him. No! Wrong perception. Come on, let me hurry this. So we got eyes have not seen, ears have not heard. See, and that's the problem. We haven't perceived that we're already blessed. We haven't perceived yet that everything that we need and want and desire is already in our world. Now, even from a non-spiritual aspect, everything you need is already here. God doesn't have to, somebody say, I need some money. God don't have to make any. It's already here. I need a house. Another house don't have to be built. Trust me. There are a lot of them. I need a new car. Nobody has to make it. It's there at the lot. Your house, your car, everything is waiting on you. And it's been waiting on you before the foundation of the world. We just don't see it. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Now, those you remember, and I got to hurry. I ended last week by saying, in order to change your perception so you can see what's already there, You need revelation. You see, because you can't receive what hasn't been revealed to you. Hallelujah. Can't receive what hasn't been revealed to you. You see, this word revelation in the Hebrew, it really means to remove the covering. Revelation means to remove the covering. In other words, when you get revelation, before revelation, it's like we see like this. But revelation removes the covering. It lifts the veil. It removes the covering. You see, without revelation, you're blind to the things of God. Let me quickly prove what I'm saying. Quickly go to 2 Corinthians 4:3. Oh, gosh. You all still with me or did you go home? 2 Corinthians 4th chapter, verse 3. It says, but if our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost, in whom the God of this world, referring to the devil, because your Bibles have a little G-O-D, in whom the God of this world has blinded, and don't say the eyes, but blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. For we preach not ourselves, but Christ Jesus the Lord, and ourselves your servant for Jesus' sake. For God, who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, has shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. So the God of this world, the enemy, has blinded the minds of unbelievers. So remember, I've said this before. You only see with your eyes, but you see through your mind.
Amen.
You know, because if you close your eyes right now and I say, think of a hot dog. You already have an image of a hot dog in your mind. I shouldn't have said food. Okay, close your eyes. Think of the Amplified Bible. Think of, I was going to say communion. I probably don't need to do that either. You see, when your mind is blind, you can't see. Can't see. And what you can't see, you can't believe. See, when it says blind in the minds of unbelievers, doubt and unbelief is only the result of no revelation. When Christians, when they have lack of faith or unbelief, I didn't say non-belief, because non-belief you believe nothing. But unbelief, when Christians have unbelief, it's only because they can't see. You doubt because you can't see it. And doubt and unbelief is only the result of no revelation. But then when you get a revelation, the covering has been lifted. The covering has been removed. You don't have to turn to it, but I think I said it last week. If you remember in 2 Kings, the 6th chapter, when the Israelites were in a battle, and then the prophet Elijah told one of his young ministers, you know, because they see the enemy, they all over the place, and the prophet Elijah tells the young minister, fear not, for they that with us are more than they that be with them. Now, in the natural, you can see anything other than the enemy and what they had. But then it says the prophet prayed and said, Lord, open his eyes. And the scripture said, the Lord opened his eyes. And then that young minister, he saw it. He saw that there was more of us than the enemy. In other words, it was already there. You remember the story when God told Abraham to take Isaac up and the mount to be sacrificed? And then when Abraham's getting ready to slay Isaac, And the Lord stopped him. And it says there was a ram in the thicket, a ram caught in the bush like that. When did the ram get there? Before the foundation of the world. See, that's why I say, and in everything that you want, need, it's already in your work. You just don't see it. Oh, my Lord, my Lord, my Lord. Hallelujah. Just don't see it. You know. In Numbers 13, when it was time for the Israelites to possess the land of Canaan, the promised land. And when Moses sent out 12 leaders, and then they came back, and only Joshua and Caleb said, hey, let's go up at once. We're well able to overcome them. Why? Because they saw it. They had a revelation. They had a different perception than those other leaders who said, we be not able to do this. They stronger than we are. We are grasshoppers in their sight. They giants. But Joshua and Caleb had a whole different perception. Yeah, the giants are real, but the truth is we're well able to overcome them. Let's go up at once. See, when you get a revelation, it ain't no more sitting down with. Soon as you see it, you're ready to go. See, and that's all it takes. And so some of you to just see it, you're not moving. You're kind of tiptoeing because you really don't see it yet. But when you see it, see, it's just like when, like, man, when you hear and you see it, you like, hey, I'm out of here. You see your new car, you ain't gonna keep going in the putt-putt anymore. When you see your new house, hey, you ain't looking to buy no more paint, no more linoleum, no more carpet for this joint. You are running because you now see it. Hallelujah. You know, you got to see that's what revelation does. Part of that perception, you can now see it. See, and that's the problem. We don't see it. We haven't seen it. Yeah. It's there. It's always been there. See, and that's part of where you got to renew your mind at. Stop saying God is getting ready to do something. God going to do something. Because what that tends to do, that keeps God in the future. God getting ready to do something. Getting ready to do something. And then, see, you keep holding on to that. And then day goes by, month goes by, year goes by, and believe it or not, you really weaken and you just saying something to remain hopeful. Because you don't want to say God ain't did nothing. See, we're putting something on God that he's not even a part of. We're trying to make God be a future God. We're trying to make God get ready to do something. When God has said, I've already done it. And then we become doubtful and get mad when things don't go the way we thought because we thought God was going to do it and he didn't do it. He can't do what he done done. I know that's not good English. We're expecting God to do something what he's already done. And we keep putting in him in the tense of he getting ready to do something. And God is saying, I ain't getting ready to do nothing. I done done this. Truth of the matter is God needs to say, when you going to do something? I felt the Holy Ghost on that one. Now, I know that get a little tight on the flesh because we're so conditioned and we're so used to waiting on God. And I'd be the first to say it by leaders, many of us are to blame of a lot of this stuff. You know? Why do next year have to be my year? Why can't today? Why can't right now, if he has already blessed me with all spiritual blessings before the foundation of the world? Now, I'm not coming against the prophetic word or nothing. I embrace it as a prophet. But see, we've got to be very careful with that. Whether you prophesy to me or not, I have already been blessed. You don't need a prophet to say you healed. You don't need nobody to tell you you've been delivered. You've all... Now, no prophets write me because I'm one, so I ain't coming against it. But if another man or woman of God don't tell me anything, he's already done it. Oh, my God. Come on, give me 5 minutes so I can quit. See, some of us got to stop that. I need a word from the Lord. I need a word from the Lord. I need a word from the Lord. You didn't got enough word, baby. Change your perception. You got the green light 10 years ago. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, what you say? He already told you to pursue, to overtake, and recover all without faith. He's already told you. Change that perception. Stop looking through the eyes of your natural senses. I can't get the house until my credit go up. I can't start the business until I go to school. I ain't coming against school. I ain't coming against credit. But stop allowing that to be your perception. Come on, 3 minutes. Y'all sit. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Told you how you perceive things, it affects how you believe and how you receive. Your perception of life affects how you live your life. See, when you get that perception that he's already done this, only thing you got to do is go out and go find it. Okay, let me end this. Now, I want to end with this last verse, and this was my foundation verse that I'd been used. Quickly go to 2 Corinthians 4:18. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. 2 Corinthians 4:18. While we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal or temporary, but the things which are not seen are eternal. You see, in order to really understand this verse, you have to really have the right perception to fulfill this verse. Because you can't effectively do this without a revelation. In other words, what revelation does is your eyes have now been opened to the truth. Your eyes have been opened to the truth that what you now see exceeds what's there. See, when that revelation is there, what you see is more real than what's there. See, because what's there is temporary. And we know anything that's temporary is subject to change. In other words, it's really you seeing the change rather than what's actually there. See, we're not denying that it's not there. It is there. Your perception of God's promise is stronger. Oh, gosh. Is stronger than the reality of that thing that's there. Oh, let me try it. What you're perceiving is not just more real, but it's the truth over the reality of that problem. See, why we look not at the things which are seen, it's there. It is real. But we're looking at what's not there. What's not there, the promise, but I perceive it. I can see it. In other words, I simplify it. The cancer is real. I'm not denying it's real. But see, when I get a revelation, my perception is, it's there, but my perception of the healing is more real than the reality of the cancer. Because the reality of the cancer is temporary. And anything, see, like I said, you can't get this unless you get a, see, if you don't have a relationship, you can't see that verse at all. See, everything here in the natural, and you got to remember this, is temporary. Nothing stays the same in the natural. Nothing here in the earth other than spiritual things is eternal. Nothing. Everything natural is temporary. Your body is temporary. Only your spirit and soul is eternal, but your body is temporary. It's natural. Every sit, these chairs, the car, it's not, it's temporary. Lack is temporary. Sickness and disease is temporary. Now you don't even have to get really too deep on that. Because if it wasn't temporary, there would be no such thing I don't want to see healing, but getting well. Amen. If sickness and disease wasn't temporary, there is no medicine in the world that can cure it. Go ahead. Now, you ain't got to think spiritual on that. Sickness and disease is temporary. If it was eternal, there is no medicine or no doctor that can cure it. So everything you can see is temporary, subject to change. Now somebody might say, well, why it seems like it's just lingering on and it's been here and this happened to so-and-so, because they couldn't see it. They couldn't see it. They didn't have the revelation that the promise is more real than the problem. See, if the problem is more real to you than the promise, then that's what's going to take you. See, that's why I understand that verse. Why we look not at the things which are temporal. No. but those which are eternal, because I got a revelation. Your problem, your situation, it's temporary. It was never designed to stay forever, and it's not going to. It's only has stayed as long as it stayed, or if it stay as long as you live, because you couldn't see. It's our blindness that has cut us off. I know. See, if you can't see it, you can't believe it. If I can't see, I've already been healed. There's no way I can believe it. And if I can't believe it, when sickness and disease come up, when lack and poverty comes up, if I can't perceive that the needs are met, I can't believe it. See, folks, this is what, and I'm just gonna have to just quit. Some of us don't need no more work. Now, I ain't saying stop studying. That ain't what I'm saying. It's part of your growth. You're gonna have to meditate, still stay on that word. But one of the things I need the body of Christ, stop blaming God. Yes, stop blaming other people. Yeah. And let's be who God has called us to be. Yes. Don't blame situation. Don't blame none of that. God has already, any and everything you need has already been provided. Yes. And the only thing you got, make that tweak, change your perception. Yes. See, because once you see it, then it's going to put you on the path you going to get it. And it doesn't matter what it is. Lack don't make a difference what it is. The doctors can say whatever. It does not matter. Now, before somebody say, well, why is it? It seems like God healed this one and then that. God is not a respecter person. See, I feel that in my spirit. God has been getting a bad rap on stuff he had never had anything to do with. God is not a respecter person. If God would heal her, not me, that would make him a respecter person. He's only a respecter of faith. He's only a respect. He's obligated to his word. He don't bless nobody more than the next. Don't exist. He don't hear my prayers more because my name on the sign. Amen. I spent years my name on the sign and didn't go too far. Go ahead. So that doesn't mean anything. Because you've been saved long, doesn't mean anything. You got to change that perception. Change it. And some of you are going to have to start in just certain areas, just small things, things that seem like it don't mean much. You know, some of you got to change your perception about cleaning your house. Yes. See, stop that perception, I don't have time. Reverend, you're doing good till you said that. I'm too busy. Change that perception. See, you're going to have, see, don't think for a moment. You just going to jump and change your perception and be able to get stuff. And that don't work like that. We go and grow from faith to faith. You know, so start at some, change your perception about certain little areas. Something, be on time. See, don't, you know, change your perception with that. Well, ain't no sense in coming to certain things. They ain't going to start, no way. Or be at your job, you know, they don't see nothing. Everybody come in late. See, start somewhere. Start changing your perception. with everything. And then once you do that, see, because if you can't be trusted with small things, see, don't think for a moment that you're going to get bigger stuff. I know I went way past my time. Come on, let's give God praise. Hallelujah. Come on, altar workers.